Welcome. In the studio with us today is Dr. Tabor Ullman of Sciences Elementary. Sciences Elementary provides cool hands-on activities for Bay Area elementary school students.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program that encompasses a diverse spectrum of topics important to our community, which we hope will both inform and entertain you. We invite you to sit back and enjoy the program.
With me today is Dr. Tabor Ullman of Sciences Elementary. Well, Tabor, you have a PhD in chemistry from Stanford and a BSc from Case Western. What motivated you to bring science and engineering to students in local elementary schools?
Well, Sarah, I started out as a mentor and tutor when I was in college in Cleveland, working with students in inner city Cleveland schools, you know, with metal detectors on the doors, and really saw the gap between how I grew up, the schools that I grew up in, and the schools that those students were growing up in. And then when I came to Stanford, when I was a TA, there were students who came to my office hours who couldn't do basic math or science concepts, such as taking 10% of 70 without a calculator, or really understanding whether an answer that they gave was a logical and a reasonable one or not. And so I thought to myself, you know, if these are freshmen at Stanford, what does that tell us about the rest of the country? And marrying my passion of science and education, I've been a lifelong science volunteer, and my experience in the for-profit and nonprofit world was brought Sciences Elementary to fruition.
Well, then, why should our audience, many of whom are in other cities or even countries, be concerned about what the students in California Silicon Valley are or are not learning about science and engineering?
That's an excellent question. And you know, Thomas Jefferson said a very long time ago that that a thriving democracy depends on an educated citizenry. And one of the foundations of an educated citizenry is an understanding of science, and not just of science, but of the thought processes that learning science develops in people. For example, if you were to go and purchase a car, you wouldn't do it just based on what your neighbor has. You would go and you would collect data, look at other cars that are out there, perhaps look at safety ratings, or you know, if you're looking for a sports car, the coolness factor, right? You would do an experiment. You would go and drive one. You would collect more data. You would come home. You would analyze your data, look at the cost, you know, and then you would draw a conclusion. That is a logical thought process. That is something that that science teaches us. Science teaches us how to make decisions based on facts and evidence, not just on dogma or opinions. Our society fails to teach our children a logical thought process and fails to teach our children how to make decisions based on facts and evidence. If elementary school is where students start their academic career, we need to start teaching them that at that early age. By the time students get to middle school or high school, their thought processes and their beliefs and how to do something are fairly entrenched. And so it's really important to start as early as possible.
How many schools and grade levels are currently benefiting from SIE? And what plans you might have to add more locations and grade levels?
Sure. So Sciences Elementary is now in its third year. We started out just with kindergarten, and every year we add a grade level. So that this year we're in kindergarten, first and second grade. We work with approximately 900 students every month with the help of 120 volunteers. We are in six schools in the Bay Area, in East Palo Alto, Mountain View, Sunnyvale, and Santa Clara. And our plans for next year, as I mentioned, we add a grade level every year. So next year we will add third grade, and we will add either one or two more schools to the program so that we will double the size of the program in the Bay Area.
Wow.
And moving forward, I really believe that this is a program that is scalable nationally to locations where there are good science, engineering, and math departments at universities. Not only are graduate students and postdocs then able to serve as volunteers, but generally whenever mm-hmm. there is such a program, there are some small companies or large companies around that university. And clearly nowhere is going to be Silicon Valley, but right. I think if you look to places like Boston or Austin or Chicago, I mm-hmm. think there is a tremendous growth potential in those cities.
In a few minutes, we're going to have a chance to observe students and SIE volunteers in some of the classrooms at Castro School. But I see you've brought some of the materials mm-hmm. used in the classroom with you. Could you briefly show us some of the items that SIE volunteers
Gladly.
Are using?
So in kindergarten, one of the units that we cover with students is a unit on sound. And we teach the students that all sound is caused by vibrations. And one of the things we have them do before we delve into the experiment is move their hand really fast back and forth. And we tell them that they're vibrating their hand.
Okay.
And then they move it next to their face, next to their uh-huh. cheek, and they can feel the air moving. So that makes the connection between mm-hmm. vibrations and the movement of air. Mm-hmm. And then what we do is we do several experiments with them. And one of the things that kids in the elementary school really like is to be able to take things home mm-hmm. and show them to their parents. And so I'm going to show you two things that we do in kindergarten. So the first thing we do is something called a finger phone. And this is actually an experiment from RAFT. RAFT is a resource area for teachers in San Jose. It's a great place. And so what this is just a half of a straw that is taped to a finger of a latex glove.
Really? It sure is.
And the first thing we do is we ask the students to blow through the straw so that and see what happens. So as you can see, the latex glove is moving or vibrating. Mm-hmm. And then we have them. This is just a piece of a cardboard tube. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the students in kindergarten don't have such great fine motor skills. And so we help them with this part. And so we just slip it over and use masking tape to tape it around. And one of the things that we really care about at Sciences Elementary is using very simple materials to do our experiments. We want our students to understand that they can do science with whatever they can find around their house. They mm-hmm. don't need to have fancy, expensive equipment in order to be scientists. So then what we do is point the phone part down so that you don't blow your ear off, and just blow into the straw.
Woo!
Now, another thing that's really interesting here is that if you pull the glove backwards and forward, you can actually change the pitch depending on how taut the material is.
Woo!
And if you put your finger on here, uh-huh. when somebody is blowing on it, you can actually feel this vibrating. So this, again, is a very hands-on, concrete way of connecting vibrations and mm-hmm. the motion of air to sound.
And so the students from kindergarten, was it, will be able to take that home
yes, they
and
go
show
home
what
with
they
this.
Learned
exactly.
and share it with their friends?
Exactly.
Very nice.
This is a classic phone. So we have some string here. And so here, this is your end of it.
Okay.
All right. And
what
so
do I
I've
do?
Already tied the paper clip to the string, and you just push it through the bottom of it.
Okay.
Now, we're going to have to pretend this is really taut. Because if it's not taught, it doesn't work. But if you talk into one end and I listen.
Hello, Tibor. Hello, can you hear me?
So now you need to listen.
Yes, I can hear you great.
And so what happens here, when the string is very taut, again, we do the same thing in first grade, vibrating the hand. When they talk into here, not only is the sound transmitted, this works really well, right? This is how the telephones were when they first started, you can touch the string gently and actually feel the vibrations moving on the string. So this shows the students not only that sound is caused by vibration, but that sound can traverse on not just in air, which is a gas, but also in a solid. And we also talked to them about sound waves And, you know, we make a wave motion with our hands to make it very concrete for them. So this is an example of a first grade experiment. So here, I'll take that.
Boy, I remember doing that as kids. That's got to be a lot of fun. We used to do that for hours.
So that's really what we try to do. We want to do things that are really fun, that the kids can do on their own, but that brings the science and the connection to science into their world, into their everyday life. So here's another everyday example. Right? Mm-hmm. These are Lego cars. What kid or adult, for that matter, doesn't love Legos? In every grade level, we do a unit on simple materials, levers, screws, pulleys, and so on. So these are just, you know, pieces of Lego that that we've picked up at the store. And we actually have the kids construct the Lego cars in the beginning. And so obviously this is something that they love doing because they get to play with Legos. Now, you'll notice that these cars are identical, except in their wheelbase.
Oh, the tires.
One wheel is much larger than the other. And the way a simple machine such as a wheel, you know, is beneficial for humans is that it helps us do work. It makes our life easier. That's why we use them. And as it turns out, bigger wheels make our life easier than smaller wheels when it's practical. And what we teach them is with the application of the same amount of force, the bigger wheel actually is able to do more work for us. So you can see that the car with the bigger wheels actually went much farther. Mm-hmm. So these are some of the activities that we do with the children.
How do you get the materials, the ideas? You don't generate them all yourselves, do you?
No. We actually don't generate very many of the ideas at all. There is so much that is available out there for free on the internet and in various books and through organizations such as I mentioned, RAFT, that it doesn't make sense to reinvent the wheel. And so what we do is we choose activities that, that as I mentioned, are really fun and where the scientific connection is obvious. We really want children to be able to observe something on their own and understand what is happening. You know, I mentioned that science is something that's evidence and fact-based. So we don't want them to have to take our word for something. We really want them to be able to see it. And so that's one thing that we think about in choosing our experiments. The other thing that we think about is all of our experiments are hands-on. We have very few demonstrations. And so it has to be something that, you know, a 5, 6, 7, 8-year-old can actually do on their own. And it can't be too complicated. Right, it has to be something that is easy for them to do and that they get a lot of enjoyment out of. And the final thing is that we really believe that there are basic science concepts that people should know, right? Such as sound is caused by vibration or what density is. And so when we create the lesson plans, we find experiments that really illustrate those things well.
Well, that's a great lead-in. I'd like us to take our audience to the classroom and experience what the students do. So we're going to take a look now at some footage of activities in progress during an energizing day at Castro School in Mountain View, California. Let's join them now.
Are we ready for science?
Yes!
Can you all say sound?
Sound!
You know this word, right?
Yes.
So now, by now, you know that sound travels, right? It travels in waves, like this. Can you make this sound, this movement? Okay, now sound is created by vibrations. That's our last word. Can you say vibration?
Vibration.
Vibration is when something moves back and forth really quick. Can you do this motion? Real quick, back and forth. And if you do it against your face, you will feel the air moving on your face. Do you feel it?
Yeah.
And that's how sound is made. By vibration. So every time you hear a sound, you would know that something somewhere is vibrating. Can you say vibrating?
Vibrating.
Excellent.
Let's take a few moments now. I'd like to go on ahead and let's visit with some of the SIE volunteers and some of the classroom teachers and learn how they have benefited from SIE and what they've gotten out of it. I'd like to kind of catch them in the moment. So let's take a minute to look at some of that footage.
I'm on the Santa Clara County School Board. I represent the North County area, Palo Alto, Mountain View, and Sunnyvale Elementary School Districts, and the Associated High School District parts that are covered by those. And I volunteer here with SIE once a month at Castro Elementary School teaching the same kindergarten class, different science units that are developed by SIE. And I really enjoy working with these kids because my work at the county office is usually centered more around early learning and the young kids that as soon as we can get them and get them early and young, we can get them achieving and interested and sparked in science. I am a former engineer, worked 18 years in industry, and I appreciate that math and science is something that the kids really need to get interested and sparked with early. And as a female, I also help represent females in the STEM business, which is science, technology, engineering, and mathematics.
I'm Hillary Frank. I live in Los Altos, and I work for Facebook. I've been volunteering with Sciences Elementary for about 6 months now, and volunteer on a monthly basis.
You mentioned earlier that in your volunteering experience, you're getting a lot of support, and in fact, before you came today, you had a little bit of a challenge.
I did. I have back-to-back meetings almost every day where I work full-time, so in order for me to make the time to come and volunteer, I have to clear my schedule for the morning and make sure that the people I'm supposed to have meetings with understand what I'm doing for that morning. So I'm always pleasantly surprised at how supportive and encouraging the people that I work with at Facebook are, giving me the opportunity to come in and volunteer for the community.
Liz Wallace, and I teach second grade at Castro. And today in Science Elementary, we worked on force and motion, and the students got a lot of hands-on experience with wheels and axles and finding out how much force you need if you have wheels versus axles. And it was a really great experience because we don't have a lot of time to prepare that material, so Science Elementary really brings it to us. They have the lessons planned, so it allows me to actually engage with the kids immediately when they need some support, rather than getting to them later after the lesson is over.
Can you briefly tell us how some of the kids reacted today after it was all over?
Well, they were excited because they were being filmed, of course, but they just loved touching stuff and playing with things, so it was fun for them to build Lego cars and to push them around and pull bricks or drag bricks, and they like the hands-on activity.
Thanks so much, Liz. And now we're going to talk to Grace, and I've asked her to share with us how she gets her classroom to be so responsive and to have the kids be so receptive. Grace.
I have a 1-2 combination class this year, and what has made it a bonus is half of the children are students that I had last year. So they were able to teach the new students the procedures and things that I have in place. And it's been really enjoyable to watch the students grow and to blossom. And this just is another way to see them do that. I have a lot of strategies in place to get their attention, and I teach them to think about learning as a challenge and that's something that they want and something to look forward to, and that's how they learn, that their brain is a muscle to exercise, and this allows them to do just that, to exercise it.
Thanks so much. It's so nice to hear that Science is Elementary is making a difference. You know, given the current financial situation in California and even in the nation, it seems that programs such as SIE can help stretch school district budgets quite a long way. But how do you do this, Tipor? What kind of resources and financial assistance do you need to keep a program like this not just going but growing?
That's another great question. So, as you saw in the footage of the volunteers are really the lifeblood of our organization. And because we work in children with small groups, we need 3 or 4 volunteers in every classroom.
Wow.
The good thing is that the volunteer commitment is fairly minimal. It's just 2 hours a month from September to May. And SIE provides the lesson plans, all the training. Even at the beginning of the year, we do a large training, and then before every session, we have some day of training, and we provide all the materials. So all the volunteers need to do is just show up. They obviously have to be willing to work with children.
Right.
And, you know, sometimes maybe even get on the floor. But it's really an easy volunteer commitment, and I think that's one of the things that draws people to the organization. You know, and all nonprofits need money.
Mm-hmm, of course.
That is something that will keep us going. And so we've been very fortunate in being able to raise money this past year from some of Silicon Valley's largest organizations, Google, Intel, Yahoo, Genentech. And in order to expand, as I mentioned, the program is doubling next year. So we really need to increase our funding.
Mm-hmm.
We're going back to those companies that have been generous to us in the past, and we're asking other companies as well for some funding. The other really nice thing that's happened this past year is that about 15% of our budget came from individual donors.
Wow.
And these are people who really care about science education and really understand that science is really one of the foundations for the success, not just in Silicon Valley, but also of the country. I mean, in, you know, President Obama's State of the Union address just a few months ago, he promised to out-educate and out-innovate. And all innovations and all the major problems that we're facing in the world right now are going to have solutions that are going to come from science, whether it's how to help us with our energy crisis, or how to make better gadgets, or how to find cures, or at least, you know, palliative type solutions for various diseases that are facing us. We need scientists for all of those things. And so it's really important to start with science at a very early age so that kids are excited and engaged. And even if they don't turn out to be scientists, they might be the decision makers on the funding. They might be the PR or the marketing people or the salespeople or just people who go to the doctor and need to understand what the doctor is telling them. So so those individuals who have been funding us really understand that. And we can use all the help that we can get. And we will be very happy to talk to anybody who wants to support us, whether as a volunteer or as a donor.
Wow, tall order. But something that you said early on in our session here was that the importance of starting this so young really, really helps with people learning how to make better decisions, how to think more clearly, how to be sure that you have all the right information. And certainly not everything that we saw today on the clips or even some of the classroom materials you brought is going to accomplish all of that. It's obviously the process that continues beyond and adding the different grade levels. Now, right now, your organization is called Sciences Elementary. I'm kind of curious, why did you focus again just on the elementary? We did talk about the fact that, of course, you want to get the students early, but what did you find when you looked around the schools that made you focus in so much on the Bay Area elementary schools?
So half of Bay Area fifth graders fail the state science test. And this is in the heart of, you know, nation's innovation in Silicon Valley. And so I wonder to myself, why is that? And as it turns out, because of various federal legislations and, you know, you mentioned state budget crises, there is very little science taught in elementary school overall. As a matter of fact, there was a study from the Lawrence Hall of Science that showed that over 87% of Bay Area elementary school teachers say that they teach science less than an hour a week. And this is an average from K through five. So because the state science test is in fifth grade, they do a lot more science then. And so there's very little science taught in K through four in many elementary school classrooms. And so I think it's actually quite astonishing that half the kids pass the test.
Good point, unfortunately.
Yeah. And so by the time these kids reach middle school, if they're not excited about science, if half of them have already failed out of science, what is the chance that we're going to get them excited in science, not just as a discipline, but just as a field of interest? I think the chances are pretty slim. And so it's really important to start early. The other thing that I think Sciences Elementary does very well is that we reach everyone. We work primarily in low socioeconomic school districts, and we reach everyone in the schools that we work in. Many after-school programs or summer camps reach a self-selected group of students who are already interested in science or whose parents think that they ought to be interested in science. And we really need everybody to be aware of what science has to offer us as a society.
Well, thanks for that expansion. Now, how can our viewers learn more about your organization, and how can they help support SIE?
So we have a website, which is www.elementaryschoolscience.org. Mm-hmm. And on our website, you can sign up as a volunteer. And of course, there's a button to donate money.
Oh, of course. It wouldn't be a nonprofit organization without a little bit of help. Well, there's so much that we could talk about, such as the wonderful training and team building you do for your volunteers. And I'm a little curious about that. We're getting close to the end of our time together today, but I'd like to hear just a little bit about what you do for your volunteers to make them feel comfortable when they jump from their real lives into your orientation and right into the classroom. Mm-hmm.
So most volunteers don't jump right into the classroom. If they want to, they're able to, but we offer two or three volunteer orientations at the beginning of the year that cover not just our organizations, but the demographics of the students that we're going to be working with, the issues that are facing public school students, and classroom management techniques, group management techniques, and mm-hmm. why we do what we do. And then, as you saw in the clips, mm-hmm. there is the day of training. The other thing that we do is we have quarterly events for the volunteers, and these are both social events. They're also networking events. We actually have had three volunteers that wanted to be teachers mm-hmm. and came and volunteered with our organization and were able to add that to their resume. And
wow.
unfortunately for us, we've lost them as volunteers, but they now have full-time jobs as teachers, which is really great. So we're mm-hmm. very, very glad to have been able to help them with that. And the quarterly events also give the volunteers an opportunity to talk with each other and share ideas about how to most effectively talk to these children who are generally from backgrounds very different from their own, facing very different challenges than they did when they were children.
I thank you again to Paul Ullman for joining us, and really thank you for bringing Sciences Elementary to the schools here in the Silicon Valley Bay Area.
Table. Is the table a liquid solid?